Yeah, start whenever you're ready.
Okay, my name is Alice Helms. Today is September 25th, 2011. I'm conducting an interview with Mary Kay Battey for the Asheville Quilt Guild Quilters SOS Save Our Stories project. We're at my home in Asheville, North Carolina, and it is 1:35 p.m. Nikki, tell me about the quilt you brought today.
This is a quilt that I made to put in the Asheville Quilt Show in 1996. It is hand quilted. The design comes from Trudy Hughes' book On Point. I can't remember exactly the name of the book. I did more than one of her designs, and I really, really enjoyed working with them. I finished this quilt, it's hand quilted, and I finished it. And on our way out to Alaska, we were camping. And right before we went over the Canadian border to get on the into Alberta, to get on the Alcan Highway, I shipped it from Montana to get it back on the show.
So you were sewing in the car?
Yeah, quilting, yeah. And getting the binding on. And
Do you do that in a big hoop?
Yes.
Yeah. So yes. There you were in the car with the big hoop.
Yeah.
Quilting.
I wasn't driving.
Yeah. Obviously, that's awkward. So, what special meaning does the quilt have for you?
I don't know if it really has any special meaning except for the memory that it does bring, that we were on our way to Alaska and we did that trip. Mm-hmm. And that was just a wonderful, wonderful experience. Mm-hmm. Going up and camping all the way up through the Yukon into Alaska and back again down the Prince Edward. I can't remember the name of that highway. All I remember, it was muddy.
Well, good thing you didn't have the quilt with you.
No.
So why don't you just describe it, the colors, the pattern, the shapes.
Well, it's called Vineyard Stars. And because the fabric is the leaves and the grapes of a vineyard, I love the purple and the turquoise together. That just turned my heart on. I just thought it was such a beautiful, beautiful combination. So that's why it's named Vineyard Stars.
Mm-hmm. And is it machine piece?
Yes. Yes, it is machine piece. Mm-hmm.
So was it, did you use templates for the shapes? Or?
No, with Trudy Hughes, you don't. That was why I was attracted to her. It's all rotary cut, and she has you cut strips and then the diagonals, and that's her whole technique, and it goes very rapidly.
Mm-hmm.
I really enjoyed it. Mm-hmm.
So how long did it take you to make it? Well, the piecing probably took not too long.
Yeah, probably about 2-3
weeks. The quilting,
probably, that's such a hard question to answer because you put it down and walk away from it.
Right.
And come back to it.
You're not punching the time clock.
Exactly. So maybe a year.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But I said, that's a real, real difficult question to ask.
I have
some quilts that are 10 years in the making because I just put them down and walked away from them.
Mm-hmm. That's okay. And how would you describe the quilting pattern? Is there a name for this?
I there's little flowers, there's the wreath pattern, and then I did diagonal lines to accentuate the stars.
Mm-hmm.
I liked it. I liked the open area so that I could. I do enjoy hand quilting, and that could really show off the quilting.
Mm-hmm.
And I did enjoy the big open areas where you could
mm-hmm.
have some fun.
Right. Yeah, it really does show it off. beautiful tiny stitches.
Thank you.
Very nice. What do you think someone viewing your quilt might conclude about you?
I don't know. That's an interesting question. That I do tiny stitches.
Mm-hmm.
this was kind of a getting into quilting. This was kind of a first step into using color because I
I'm a little bit afraid of color. My husband's always saying I don't dress. He says your quilts are just beautiful, but you don't do the same in your clothing. And you're always wearing black and browns. But I really stepped out of the box. It's for me with this one. And then I went even further, as I showed you with the other couple of quilts I've made.
So this was made in 1996. So that was a while back.
Yeah.
How do you use the quilt now?
It's stored. You know, they say that once you should sleep under every quilt one time, and you'll know if it's a good quilt or a bad quilt by the dreams you have. And I had nightmares under this quilt. I've only slept under it one time, and I had a nightmare that night, and I have never slept under it since, and have not allowed anybody else to sleep under it. So it's stored. I have an antique showcase at home, an old glass cabinet, and it's folded and stored in there. I pull it out and refold it every now and then.
Mm-hmm. So what are your plans for it in the future?
I guess somebody will get it. But I guess it's a little creepy to me because I'm not sure I really want to give it to anybody to sleep under. It's very superstitious, I know, but...
Well, maybe that's just your experience. Maybe someone else...
Well, that could be. Want to try it? Yeah.
Okay, tell me about your interest in quilt making. What age were you when you started quilting?
I was an adult. I was in 1983. In my 40s, maybe. 30s. 20s. My girlfriend, I was working full time down in Florida, and my girlfriend called me and said she had found someplace where we could go learn quilting. And I thought, you're out of your mind, because I had another friend that had taken up quilting, and I walked out of her house after her telling me about it and thinking, you've got to be kidding me. You know, I cannot imagine working on a quilt for years and years and years. But I went, and she never did another thing, and I was hooked. I was absolutely hooked. And I joined a little bee down there, and we had a lot of fun. I love it because of the networking with other women.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's has been the best part of quilting, is how the people I've met, the women I've met. When you retire, when you've been in a high-stress job working with very intelligent people, when you retire, you get a little nervous about that. And you wonder if you're ever going to have that give and take again. And that has absolutely happened with quilting and with the women that I associate with now in Asheville. Just work with very, very demanding women that have wonderful sense of humor and that are strict with their how they want things done and have intelligence. And I really, really enjoy that part of it, is the friends I've made.
Mm-hmm. So back in the 80s in Florida, there were a lot of active quilters.
Oh yeah, Florida's big in quilting. It really is. I was very surprised.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I guess I would think, you know, it's Florida, it's hot. They don't need blankets anyway.
Yeah, I know. Yeah, you fold them up and you put them away. And then all people do use the quilts. I mean, Florida can get pretty chilly in the wintertime.
Mm-hmm. So. Right. So you learned how to quilt. It was just a beginning quilt class at a shop.
Yeah. Yes, and first quilt I did, I did the same thing everybody else does. I went out and bought 5,000 yards of fabric and just went absolutely crazy. Nothing matched anything else. I really didn't know what I was doing. I took a color class, which was the best thing for me, and things started kind of settling into place. But the first quilt I made was a queen size. Now, actually, I shouldn't say that. I made several small quilts, but I made the big one, the first big one I made for my husband. And on the back of it, it says, for supporting my fabric habit.
Does he still have it?
Oh, yeah.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
So it's about 30 years old or 25?
Goodness. Yeah, it didn't get finished. It didn't get finished until for about 10 years. So, yeah, now think about it. Yeah, I guess it is.
Do you like it?
I do.
So you still like it. You liked it then?
Yes.
And you still like
it? Yes.
That's good.
Yeah.
So, how many hours a week do you quilt?
Not enough. It seems like something is always coming up. and I plan, my plan for this month is once I get through our quilt show is coming up, once I get through that and get through my husband's birthday, then I'm going to be sitting down and doing some quilting. Mm-hmm. My grandkids, on the other hand, they seem to be doing really well with that.
So it's just whenever you can.
Yes, yes, yeah. You know, and I do knit too, so that takes up a lot of time.
Right. Mickey, what is your first quilt memory?
My first quilt memory? Probably when I walked in on my girlfriend, she told me that she was going to make this quilt. I was raised in Florida, so quilting was never in my background. Mm-hmm. Although a few years ago I found out that my great-grandmother was a quilter. I never knew that. Mm-hmm. And there is a quilt out there that she made, but I did not get it. I'm a little disappointed in that, but hopefully it has a good home.
Oh, okay. So you didn't have quilts when you were a child?
No,
or...
no. Like you said, we lived in Florida.
Yeah.
And there was no air conditioning back then.
But your great-grandmother was a quilter, did mm-hmm. she live in Florida?
She lived in New York.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. My mom's from New York, my mom and dad were. Mm-hmm.
Interesting. Too bad you couldn't have known her.
Yeah.
How does quilt making impact your family?
Financially?
However.
I think... How does it impact my family? Well, the fact that I have a whole room to myself in the house probably impacts the family. And anybody that comes to visit, all the grandkids have to sleep up in the quilting room, so things just kind of get shoved aside and they sleep on the floor. The other way it's impact the family is that I have 7 grandkids and all but 2 have made their own quilts, including the boys. So I think that's the biggest impact, is that the kids know about quilting and they know what quilts are and they appreciate quilts. Mm-hmm. In fact, I just had a grandson visit this morning. I dragged him up here one year when he was about 16 years old and told him that he could come up. I would fly him up, but he had to work the quilt show. And I mentioned to him that the quilt show was coming next week, and he's just said, "I'm ignoring you. I'm never speaking to you again about quilt shows," because I worked his little fanny off. So I don't think he's even going to come over for the show.
He's not hooked.
He's not hooked, but he's, he's one of the ones that never made his own quilt. But they all have a quilt that I've made.
So you were quilting before they were born, so they've grown, your grandchildren mm-hmm. have grown
right.
up with
right.
you quilting.
Yeah, they all know how to work the sewing machine. They've all played with the fabric.
Mm-hmm. Well, while we're on the subject, why don't you describe the room that you quilt in?
It's an upstairs loft. It had a design wall. I had to take it down, but I can put it up. It's kind of portable. I have my cutting board set up. Fabric is sorted by color in the closet when it's not sprayed out on the floor. I have a bookcase that holds several quilts and my quilting books. And I play music up there. Mm-hmm. Sometimes watch TV. Mm-hmm. And play with fabric.
So it's everything you would want it to be,
yeah.
It sounds like.
Yeah.
And you have a design wall?
I do. It's kind of comes up, goes up, and comes down. Mm-hmm. When the company's there, I jerk it down because it's not the most attractive thing.
Mickey, have you ever used quilts to get through a difficult time?
I don't even know how to answer that. I've used my quilting, the ability to facilitate quilting to help others, not necessarily myself yet. Mm-hmm. The time might come. Mm-hmm. Well, actually, I take that back. Yes. When my mother was diagnosed with cancer, The first thing I had to do, I had to make a quilt, and I knew I didn't have much time. So I put together a quilt top, and I tied a quilt for her, because I didn't have time to quilt it. And I took it down with me to Florida, and I lived with her for her last 3 months. And she slept under that quilt in her last days.
Mm-hmm.
So, yes. Another thing, I lost a friend recently to ALS, and I went over to the house right after she passed, and her friends had gotten her prepared for to be taken. And when she was rolled out of the house, she was under her favorite quilt. And that just, it made us all feel really good.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it was just such a comforting thing that that they did that instead of what they would normally do.
Mm-hmm.
So it was nice.
And was it a quilt she had made?
Yes.
Ah.
Yeah.
That's wonderful. I've never heard that before.
Yeah.
That's a wonderful idea.
Mm-hmm.
What do you like most about quilting?
I like the handwork. Yeah, and I do like the making the tops. I never caught on to machine quilting. I'm not good at it. I know that. So since I do like making the tops, and I don't really seem to have enough time in my life to do hand quilting as much as I'd like to, I make the tops and I get them machine quilting now.
Uh-huh.
Get them done.
Mm-hmm. You pay someone to do it on a long arm.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So I think you just told me what you do not enjoy, machine quilting, right?
No.
What quilting groups do you belong to?
I'm on a Bugcatcher quilting bee, which is the oldest bee in Asheville.
Mm-hmm.
I think they've been around. They've been around since the mid-70s, I believe.
Okay.
And actually, a lot of the charter members of the Asheville Quilt Guild were members of Bugcatchers, I believe,
mm-hmm.
in the beginning. And kind of the guild kind of came out of that bee.
Mm-hmm.
So, and then I belong to the guild.
Mm-hmm.
And there are others.
Okay. So what do you do at the Bugcatchers bee? How often do you meet? What do you
they
do?
They meet once a week. Just sit around with a bunch of women and talk. There's no structure to it. There's no doing special quilts. People work on their own,
mm-hmm.
their own projects. Get a little help from other people. If you're getting ready to baste a quilt, you always have a crew there to help you baste it, which is always wonderful.
Mm-hmm.
And eat.
Mm-hmm.
That's a good thing. Yeah.
Do people bring machines?
No,
so it's all
handwork. Yes,
uh-huh.
All handwork.
But do you have tables that you can use
mm-hmm.
for
right.
sandwiching quilts?
Right.
So weekly, meet weekly.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's
I don't always get there, but they do meet weekly. Always go to the first of the month, though. That's when the food's there.
Oh, okay. Is it a potluck?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
And Southern women know how to cook.
Yeah. So, tell me about the Asheville Quilt Guild. How long have you been a member?
I've been a member since 1994. We moved here. We moved to Asheville in 1993, and I joined in 1994. It was a smaller guild when I first joined. It had 125 members off and on. And then in 1 year, it exploded. It doubled when the baby boomers retired. And the guild's very, very active in a lot of community efforts. I think they made something like, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, over 300 quilts they gave to community maybe this year. And they put on the Asheville Quilt Show, which has just gotten bigger and bigger. When I first joined, we held it in the gymnasium at Carolina Day School. And I was chair the last year we did that, and we barely could move in there. And then we were invited out to the Arboretum, and now we've outgrown it. So we're going to try the Ag Center this year and see how that works.
Mm-hmm.
But it's a very, very active guild, very diverse. I think we are beginning to cover the spectrum of not only traditional but art quilts, and also age groups. I've noticed that we're getting a lot of younger members,
mm-hmm.
and I think that's a good thing. Mm-hmm. I think it's a very, very good thing. Because
mm-hmm.
I hate to see quilting die out like it did in the 50s and 60s.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Do you think that this area has more active quilters than maybe some other parts of the country? Or even parts of the state of North Carolina?
I think it does, only because big quilters like to live in the mountains too. It's like they say about our medical community, we have a great medical community because good doctors like to live in the mountains. Obviously, quilting has been in the mountains for a very, very long time in
mm-hmm.
Appalachia. But I think the way it's grown in the past 15 years or so is because of women and men coming to the mountains to retire and then working on their art.
Mm-hmm. Did you belong to a quilt guild when you lived in Florida?
No, I did not. I belonged to a bee. We were called the Black Sheep. We all worked. We met at night. We met once a week at night. We all worked. We wanted to get away from structure. We didn't need any organization, so there was about 15 of us, and we just met at the school once a week. And had no president, no, we didn't want any of that stuff, because
right.
that's what we were escaping from.
Right. So do you think it's important to have organizations like the guild, like the Asheville Quilt Guild, as well as smaller groups?
Yes, absolutely.
Or circles?
Yeah, I think a big guild like ours can be very, very intimidating. I know it was for me when I first walked in. And I think the bees, especially if you're new to the area or new to quilting, I think getting into a smaller bee where you have mentors that will help you and encourage you, that inspiration kind of gets lost in a big guild.
Mm-hmm.
Although you do have the wonderful teachers that come in and speak, those women and men they're wonderful, but you can be very, very intimidated. So I think the bees are extremely important.
Mm-hmm. And there are a lot of bees
mm-hmm.
in this area,
yeah.
too.
Yeah.
I've noticed. Maybe we've already answered this. Do you have a favorite technique or a favorite material or something? Do you work with a lot of different
things? I like contemporary fabrics. I love geometric patterns. Appliqué is not my thing. I'm so glad some people like to do it so I can look at it. I'm not the least bit interested in trying to do it. and I'd kind of like to explore that and go more contemporary than I have,
mm-hmm.
but that opportunity hasn't come up
mm-hmm.
yet, but it will.
Okay. What do you think makes a great quilt?
Well, I know what the judges think makes a great quilt. I think what makes a great quilt is the love that goes into it. My granddaughter was here this summer, and we have a local shop hop, and she went on the shop hop with us and almost broke the bank buying fabric. And my husband and I have been invited out to dinner, and she's 14 years old, and I said, "Do you mind being left here by yourself?" And she said, "No, that's fine." And I had cut up her fabric for her. And when we got home that night, she was done. She had a lap quilt top done, finished. And she is just so excited about it and so pleased with herself. And I think maybe that's what makes a good quilt, is the pride that it brings to the quilt maker.
Mm-hmm.
And like I say, I know what the judges think makes a great quilt.
And they don't measure that quality, do
right.
they?
No.
That's the unknowable to a judge.
Exactly.
Judging an anonymous person's quilt.
So, but I like that. You know, if they were wonky, that's fine. Mm-hmm. And it's like I say, it's the pride
mm-hmm.
that the quilt maker has in her.
Yeah, that's interesting. Mm-hmm. What do you think makes a great quilt maker?
Somebody that likes chocolate and red wine.
Mm-hmm.
I guess that's up to the individual person. I enjoy sharing the work I do. I've facilitated classes out at Camp Bluebird, and I don't know if we've already talked about that or not, which is a retreat for cancer patients. I've done that for years. They have one quilt that survived the fire. It was in the fire that we had here recently, and I have it at the house airing it out. And the people have came in. They were not quilt makers. They didn't know anything about what they were doing, but we used Wonder Under, and they made the most fabulous quilt. Mm-hmm. Each block is very, very individual, and we are doing another set right now. We are going to be tying it. So the second part of that, we did the first one in 1998, and we've done other things, and then for the past 2 years, they've been working on blocks, and we've assembled those, and they're going to be tying those quilts. So mm-hmm. it's the memories of the people and what they're going through
mm-hmm.
that they show. Another thing that I've gotten involved in is organ donors. The families of organ donors make quilt blocks after after that donation has been made, and they every year they have a dinner. And they bring these families together, and they have a ceremony where they give the blocks. And I have taken it on to put those blocks into small wall hangings that can be shown around Asheville.
Uh-huh. So this is a local group?
Mm-hmm. It's a mission at the hospital.
Okay.
Yeah. And it's and their blocks will tug at your heart.
Uh-huh.
They really will.
Uh-huh.
And they go from... I think the youngest organ donor is 10, and the oldest is in his 80s. So you can mm-hmm. be an organ donor for a long, long time.
Mm-hmm. So what do you think why do you think quilting appeals to people who have, you know, suffered a tragedy, a disease, or a medical...
I don't know if, I think it's a way of expressing yourself as, and your feelings that you're feeling, and the fact that quilts last. They go into history, and people take care of the quilts,
mm-hmm.
and those quilts will be here long after we're gone. And I love going into antique stores and finding a really nice quilt, and you wonder about the quilt maker, and I brought a few of those home.
Mm-hmm.
Just because I hate to see them sitting in the store.
I
know,
it's not right.
No, it isn't. I think they need a home.
Yes. I agree. Are there any quilters whose works you're particularly fond of, or...
Well, let's face it, we have some of the best quilt makers in the United States right here in Asheville.
Yeah.
We are so lucky. I love the humor of Linda Cantrell's and the precision work of Barbara Sweeney is
mm-hmm.
amazing. And I've been lucky enough to call her a friend, so I've been out in her studio and watched her work and learn so much from her, and
mm-hmm.
she's been a great, great mentor, and she's encouraged me quite a bit.
Mm-hmm.
As far as far flung, I think any quilter that gets to finish her quilt and be proud of it is. It's amazing. And if you don't finish it, that's fine too. I've sent an awful lot of UFOs to Goodwill, hoping that somebody else will pick them up and continue on.
Well, that's interesting. That's an interesting
thing. I don't hang on to the guilt, because if I do, I get bogged down in it. Mm-hmm. And if I'm tired of fabric, or if it doesn't talk to me anymore, I don't let them sit there. I just make them go.
Mm-hmm.
I go through my fabric stash about once a year and get rid of stuff that I know I'll never use.
Mm-hmm. So maybe when someone sees that unfinished quilt top in Goodwill, they think the same thing you do.
Yeah.
When you see a empty quilt.
Could be.
You feel bad, and then
yeah,
go
take it home. Yeah.
Finish it. Hopefully, it's a cycle. Why is quilt making important to your life?
Again, because of the connections, the networking.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. If we had moved to Asheville, my husband actually came home. He was born here. If we had moved to Asheville and I hadn't had quilting, I'm not really quite sure how I would have made the connections I've made the friends I've made.
Mm-hmm.
It's, and I think you probably feel the same way.
Yes,
yeah.
I do.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's real important.
Right.
Especially fabric shopping together.
Right. what has happened to the quilts that you've made for your friends and family? Do you know?
Well, most of them, I actually saw my 23-year-old granddaughter's baby quilt when I went to visit her in Texas the other day, and it's very, very fragile and very thin, but it's still there. I made a quilt for a real, real good friend, having her first grandchild, and they were so excited. And they camp with us, they're campers. And so I made her a quilt, my friend the quilt, so that she could keep it in the camper, and her granddaughter, or it turned out to be her granddaughter, she could always have a quilt in the camper. Well, apparently when she was a toddler, she took the quilt home. And as I understand it, it's about 6 inches square left of it. She has loved that thing to death. But luckily her aunt took up quilting, so now she has some new quilts.
Uh-huh. Do you worry about the quilts you've given to people?
No. The only thing I ask is that they don't take them to the beach. But other than that, it's not mine anymore. Once you give it away, you give it away.
Yes. And you think it should be used?
Yeah, oh, absolutely. Absolutely. The antique quilts I buy, I use on the beds.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, they absolutely should be used. And loved and hugged and cuddled. And
mm-hmm.
I make all the kids, when they graduate from high school, they get a quilt. And I put on their, on the label that anytime you're feeling lonesome, just crawl under these.
Mm-hmm.
And baby quilts. I've made baby quilts for my nieces and nephews. And I put on the label because people will take those quilts that you make for the babies and they'll put them away.
Mm-hmm.
And this is for them to sit upon, play upon,
mm-hmm.
do anything they want to upon it. It's their quilt.
Mm-hmm. Good. What do you think is the biggest challenge confronting quilt makers today?
Wow. Trying to find unique designs. And I don't know if there are any challenges that are unsurmountable. That where these women and men have taken quilting has just astounded me. Absolutely astounded me. You know, when we got into it, it was this kind of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And now they're the embellishments and the designs and the techniques. And I think the only challenge is your imagination.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you're unlimited by that.
Right. Okay, well, I think we've come to the end of our questions here. Is there anything else on your mind about quilting that you'd like to add to this?
No, I think you covered it.
Okay.
Thank you.
Very good.
For the opportunity. I appreciate it.
Thank you, Mickey. And this concludes our interview. And it is now 2:07 p.m.